With this, let's move to the first session of the day, a panel discussion on global commodities. For the same, it's a pleasure to invite and introduce the moderator for this panel discussion, Manisha Gupta. She's editor, Commodities and Currencies for CNBC TV 18. She has been covering the domestic and global commodity and currency space for more than a decade now. Prior to joining Network 18, she was heading commodities and research for leading brokerage firms. She's an MBA and a PG in International Exports and Imports Regulations. Over to you, Manisha.
Gaurav, thank you so much for that, and thank you for those kind introductions. And I want to thank you, the CFA Society of India as well, for this opportunity, and congratulations on the Commodity and Currency Conference 2021 as well. I also want to introduce my co-panelists here. We are joined by Mr. Chirag Sheth. He's Principal Consultant, Metals Focus, Southeast Asia. We also have with us Kishore Narne, who's Director, Motilal Oswal Group, and Jovi Tevez, who's Precious Metal Strategist at UBS. Thank you so much for joining us. And while clearly commodities has been the flavor of the last 12 months, as we've seen, almost everybody seems to be talking about commodities. And why not? Because we've seen multi-year highs, we've seen all-time highs come in case of commodities. It has been called as a super cycle, a bull run. And we have seen a huge amount of liquidity into the markets. There has been stimulus from global central banks. There is a lot of pent-up demand coming in after the pandemic has led to opening up of restrictions here. And then there is a huge fund buying that we've seen, a lot of money allocations across commodities as well. So Kishore, let me start with you first. There have been various reports, there has been various data which has been supportive of the fact that commodity in some sense became an overcrowded trade. There also was a report from Bank of America suggesting that nearly 1:9 standard deviation above long-term allocations is what we saw in commodities. Now that we've seen some bit of a profit taking, how would you take a step back and analyze this scenario?
Yeah, good evening, Manisha. I think I actually don't put entire commodities into one basket. I don't see it as a complete asset class like equities. So equities is predominantly economy growth, consumption related business profits, which typically accumulate into stock market returns. But in commodities, unlike that, every commodity is very different geographically, consumption wise, the way it is utilized, the way we have inventories. So it's all completely different in fundamentals. Maybe you can actually make them into smaller groups like energy, precious, and non-ferrous, ferrous, all the kind of groups. But so commodities as an asset class is not a trade. So always you'll find good trades within that asset class. So right now, yes, gold has been a huge trade for the last 3-4 years, especially liquidity-driven rally as well. And the pandemic led fears of investing into safe haven assets. So that actually which created that tailwind for gold, though fundamentally it looks to be bullish still because of the loss of value in fiat currencies, et cetera, et cetera. But I think as the consumption resumes globally post-pandemic, I think non-ferrous metals, industrial commodities are going to be a significantly larger trade and a better trade than even precious metals for that matter.
Well, we have two experts on precious metals, and I'll come to you in just a bit. But Kishore, one more point. So while we did see a huge surge in case of commodities, and I won't put it in the same basket as you advise, but there was a pent-up demand, there were global supply disruptions, and we saw a huge run-up. That seems to be plateauing right now. The Chinese growth numbers, the trade data, manufacturing numbers, GDP numbers that we've seen in the previous week itself seem to be slowing down. Is the growth now going to come from other countries? Is commodities still in play?
Yes, commodities are still in play. So though China has been the world's manufacturing hub, so Chinese numbers to some extent have been plateauing because they have actually pushed up their inventory levels starting from January this year onwards, especially first quarter 2021 calendar year. They have pushed up inventory significantly, and it is damn well expected that their further buying will be slowed down. Second is the regulatory intervention within China, where the Chinese government and regulators want to cool off the commodity rally, and they have put various restrictions, etc., so which to some extent cooled down the nerves, but it doesn't mean that demand is going away. So I think we still have supply related issues, logistical issues, but demand is cropping up very fast, especially in the Western countries, where eventually again China is going to be supplier and China is going to buy back into the markets. So at this point of time, the panic within the Chinese government and the regulators who try to intervene and cool off, that itself is showing me that there is a significant upside still coming up.
Let's talk about individual commodities then. And Chirag, let me start with you. When we talk about India, the portfolio diversification in gold perhaps has picked up in last 1 year more than what we've seen in the past. As we've already spoken, always spoken, that gold is over-owned when we look at households and physical buying, but under-owned when we look at gold as a financial instrument. Would you say last 1 year has changed that?
Indeed, Manisha. I think, we had this discussion early last year where, how did we see that probably, individual wealth managers, you had, mutual fund managers starting to talk about gold and how gold should play an important part of one's portfolio. While, we've always said that, maybe 4 to 5% would be an optimal, allocation to gold. Obviously, the percentage needs to change with the time, that we are in. So obviously, during the time of COVID, we did see that a lot of fund managers and a lot of wealth managers started telling their clients to increase the holdings to gold probably by 10% or 15%. So in a sense, I think there is a certain amount of allocation which is always required, but then that it can keep on changing as the time, if you are into a situation of an economic distress, then you increase your holding towards gold. And as the recovery happens, probably you will reduce your holding towards gold. So gold is now truly, in terms of India becoming a financial asset rather than people just buying gold as a jewelry, you suddenly find digital gold, sovereign gold bond, ETFs, kind of pick up, and the holdings have increased by nearly 50-60% in some of these cases.
Really? Johnny, let me come to you. And, we've seen money rotation. We've seen a lot of liquidity, and that has led to various asset classes increasing higher. Gold perhaps was the first one to do that. We saw an all-time highs in 2020. And since then, there has been quite a bit of a correction. Even as we continue to talk about inflation, even as we talk about diversification, the takers in sense of gold have actually led into profit-taking. We've seen money rotation and other things. How would you look at the current scenario in the global markets and how gold stands as an asset class?
So I think at this point, considering the expectation, the macro expectations, the recovery is going to continue. Policies are likely to normalize. Real rates are going to move higher. I think that's why we're seeing this correction in gold. And in fact, we do see further weakness from current levels into the end of the year and will extend into next year because of that. I think gold as a diversifier for portfolios continues to be quite relevant. But I think in a scenario where you have a more positive macro backdrop, those level of allocation should also naturally decline.
So what is your sense, Joni, on where is gold headed?
So we have a year-end target of around $1,700 for the end of this year, and we expect prices to move lower further next year towards $1,600 by the end of 2022. We are expecting that this move will be moderate. It'll be quite gradual because, as I mentioned earlier, I think gold's role as a portfolio diversifier remains intact. So you do have those strategic players that will be quite resilient.
All right. So when you say 1700 by end of this year and 1600 by end of the next year, that doesn't sound very bullish. But let me talk to Chirag then. Chirag, what is your sense on gold prices? I mean, are you in agreement with what Joni said?
Well, we have got a slightly bullish outlook towards gold. I think the couple of things that probably have to look at is that we are again seeing probably rise in infection because of the Delta variant. in many of the emerging markets, as well as, you know, yesterday, the CDC has come out with, you know, a red flag that the unvaccinated is another pandemic, you know, in the being. So obviously the economic recovery is going to get impacted by the rising COVID, you know, infections. Also, the fact that we believe that probably, you know, the market is pricing a bit too early an interest rate hike, while, you know, people got excited after the June dot plot that came out when we saw this sharp, you know, fall in, you know, gold prices. We believe that if inflation continues to rise, you know, the real yields will continue to remain negative. And that would mean that there is a little competition to gold when it comes to, you know, safe haven asset. So we believe that probably, you know, $2,000 is where we could see gold prices by the end of the year. That said, you know, we believe that we are nearing the bull run, and over the next, you know, couple of years time, we could see significantly lower, you know, gold prices.
Okay. One of you is $300 off the target where the gold prices perhaps are headed. But Kishore, do you want to break this chain? I mean, do you want to tell us on what you think where the gold prices are headed? Let's go with that first. Kishore, are you on mute?
Yeah, so traditional techniques will tell you still gold should be bullish, because in an era of money printing and in an era of liquidity, gold is naturally tend to perform. And also there is absolutely no doubt that inflation is going to spike sharply. And I tend to see that central bankers historically have fallen always behind the inflation curve. So it would be a bit nerve-wracking for central bankers to raise interest rates faster than the inflation can rise. That's always been proven, because the politicians normally keep you pulling back. So I have my doubts, especially in emerging market currencies. The gold will continue to perform, because either way, it is an imported inflation as the global commodity prices rise, as the liquidity continues to be there. At the same time, rise of demand will either way push the commodity prices, which will eventually drop into the emerging market currencies, which will collapse or maybe deteriorate from here, and anyway provide that base for the gold prices in emerging markets. But in dollar terms, yes, I think I would go with Chirag. Probably, I'm not saying that it will not go to 1700, but it might go to 2100 first and then go to 1700. So again, time, maybe we might be a little off. So I think in the next 16, 18 months, I think the gold would be either toiling around here or maybe higher, but not lower, because 1700 already we have seen just a couple of months back. And from there, we are going up. I think 2100 is on cards. Probably that earlier bets of 2400 plus and all those things are off at this point of time. Probably everyone has pulled them back a little bit. So 2100 is possible within 12 to 18 months.
Joni, do you want to answer to that? And while going with their view on or the price targets and gold, yes, it does make sense to include it in your portfolio, not so much with 1700, where you are expecting the gold prices to decline from here. What is your sense on why do you see the gold prices decline from here on? And if you are not so bullish on gold, are you bullish on the other precious metals then?
So I guess the point about gold being part of an investor portfolio for diversification purposes is really because of its correlation with all the other assets that an investor would tend to hold, like equities and bonds. So it's not so much, and I think that's the value that currently is quite important for investors as far as gold is concerned, that, you know, it provides that offset for their portfolio in case some of the other asset classes, you know, come under pressure. And I think that sort of element will continue. So the way we look at gold, the two key drivers really for prices is real rates and the US dollar. We are bearish on the US dollar, which should be supportive for gold. However, we have looked at periods when the global economy is expanding, which where we are at the moment. And typically during these kinds of periods, the relationship between gold and the dollar tends to be weaker. So the dollar doesn't tend to be an important or significant driver for gold prices. What does come up as a key driver for gold during these types of periods is real rates. And we are expecting real rates to move higher from here. And I think, you know, it is quite intuitive why real rates are an important driver for gold. It's a question of opportunity cost. So the higher real rates are, the more expensive it is to basically be sitting on gold holdings that are naturally non-yielding, a non-yielding asset. So that's how we would look at it. And as far as the rest of the precious metals are concerned, I think that there is a very strong positive correlation between gold and silver, platinum, and palladium. Obviously, for the white metals, they do have a strong industrial component to it in terms of their usage. So the fundamentals would matter there. But I think gold's overall direction does also impact all of these other metals. From a long-term perspective, I would say the metal that we do have an upside or sort of an upward price forecast profile is platinum. So we're talking about over a five-year horizon. We do see platinum prices moving higher from current levels. For silver, we think it will be very, very closely following gold's direction. And for palladium, we actually have a downward sloping price profile over a five-year period because of fundamental reasons.
All right, so it's going to be silver and platinum as far as Joni is concerned in sense of bullish cues there. Chirag, when it comes to the Indian markets, I mean, it has been a lot of push. It has been a lot of work that has gone in for telling people to include gold in their portfolio as a financial instrument. When we look at the other, precious metals, platinum and palladium, while of course it's a precious metal, there is some jewelry available for platinum, but mostly we track it because it also is it's used in the automotive industry there. And is the reason we've seen the deficit, the price rise, etc. So when you look at the Indian portfolio, what is your sense when it comes to precious metals? Are we even talking anything more than gold? Because at least in case of gold, we have a gold ETF, you have digital gold, you have gold funds, etc. For the other precious metal prices, they're little nothing.
Right, Manisha, absolutely. I think the only one precious metal which Indians have really invested towards outside gold has been silver. Over the last probably 8 to 10 years, we've seen phenomenal amount of imports of silver happening into India. And large part of that has been because of investment demand for silver. So, you know, our estimate is that anywhere between 15 to 18,000 tons of silver was, you know, bought by Indians in form of, bars or, coins. And that is also why that you are seeing right now for the last, 8 to 12 months, there has been virtually no import of silver coming to India, because suddenly last year we saw about 100% rally in silver prices. A lot of investors who had bought silver at lower prices are actually, kind of exiting, the silver holdings. That said, I think there is a certain amount of interest towards platinum, but there are no avenues available. Even some of the, we are aware of refineries who tried to sell, platinum coins, because the market was so small, the margins were so high that, investors actually were not too keen to buy. One of the biggest importance that one looks at while investing is how easy it is to exit those investments. And what is the impact cost? So today, if you actually go to buy gold coin, you would get gold coin anywhere between 1 to 5% making charges, depending on the size of the gold coin. Similar goes for silver as well. But if you were to go to buy platinum, the making charges would range from 10% to 15%. Now, which means that if anybody is buying platinum, they would have to first wait for platinum prices to rally by 10%, then make profit, and then again go back to the market and sell. Where again, the difference between the price, the buying price and selling price is exceptionally high. So unless and until there is no, vibrant market, no transparent pricing, the platinum investment market may not pick up in India, and we may still continue to remain a gold and a silver market.
I want to come on the prices part of that, but I'm going to give this a bit of a break. And I want to ask Kishore on what he really thinks about the metal prices here, because there are just so many people who invest in metals in India, not so much for the underlying commodity. I mean, that has been growing as well, but it is really the metal related stocks which the markets really have been buying into. So while Kishore, we have seen an all-time high in copper, in steel, in iron ore, and multi-year highs again in nickel, aluminum, zinc, etc., what is your sense on where the metals are headed? And the whole point being that out, you know, 31 Nifty 50 companies are commodity related companies there. So I don't know how much people actually tend to follow commodities, but the fair point is that much of the commodity price movement does impact all of these companies. Metal specifically, what's your sense on that?
See, Manisha, in India, the play in metal related equities is predominantly zinc, aluminum, and copper to some extent, especially the smelting side, actually not on the mining side. So so that way we feel that copper has little bit of room upside, but it has had a massive rally, though a large amount of fundamentals have been discounted in that. And we feel that aluminum is actually aptly priced, probably even it is slightly ahead of its fundamentals. So we are not bullish on aluminum. So and zinc is something which can be another 15%, 20% upside could be potentially possible. But I think the dominant play in metals market today, even medium to long-term perspective, is nickel. So unfortunately, we don't have any nickel-related stocks in India. Though it's a 100% imported metal for India. So nickel is a big play. Actually, if you're looking at next couple of years, maybe 3 to 4 years also, and the entire EV boom and all. So that's going to be a big play strategically. Copper has a room, maybe another 30% upside. So that's where, but the issue is on the smelter side, probably the margins are not that great. And the margins are not expected to improve also at the because the miners are going to make most of this money. So on the mining side, exposure could be better than the smelting side. So this is how the perspective related to equities as far as India is concerned. But if you're looking at a global perspective, probably any mining companies, especially copper or all these BHP billitons and all, are looking still good.
And what is your sense on steel and iron ore? Because these have done all-time highs and there are a lot of companies who actually look at that. So is it good to still have it on your portfolio, considering that China is the biggest producer and consumer of these couple of metals?
Yes, see, ferrous side is still bullish. And though the shipments have slowed down in the last 8 weeks or so, but I think with the kind of rift between US and China, probably there could be some issues there, but I think iron ore is still iron ore, or either it is even finished products like long products or flat products. I think the entire infrastructure boom which is coming in, including US, there's a huge infrastructure spending which is expected to be positioned for the next 3-4 years or 5 years perspective. So I think those are the stocks which one should be looking for.
All right. So when it comes to base metals, it's going to be copper and nickel, and ferrous metals, steel and iron ore both seem quite good. The reason I interjected metals is because when we talk about silver, silver is 50% base metal, industrial metal that is, and 50% of precious metal. Silver is has found a lot of usages, especially in the industrial metals, and especially with the whole EV talk, silver usage is only expected to be going higher in the solar panels as well. So Chirag, when it comes to that, what is the kind of demand expectations are we looking at from silver? And I do want to get your price view on that too.
I think Manisha, you're right. You know, our expectation is that probably from the photovoltaic side, you know, silver will continue to remain in fairly good state. And also the fact that we are now talking about, you know, there's a lot of stress given on green technology, electrical vehicles. And I think it's important, we did a study, a few months back, and we found out as, cars get more high tech, as more computer, processors are put into the car, the points where silver is used keeps on increasing at a multiple pace. So obviously as EVs, I would say penetration of EV increases, look at India itself, you are seeing more and more car manufacturers coming out with electrical vehicles. Yesterday, Ola opened an electrical scooter booking, and in 24 hours, 100,000 electrical scooters were booked. So obviously electrical vehicles is gaining, I would say, acceptance across the globe, and that obviously helps silver. So our sense is industrial demand will continue to remain fairly strong. We are looking at anywhere between $30 to $32 for silver over the next 12 to 16 months time.
All right, $32 to $32 per ounce. What's your sense, Kishore?
I think I go with him anyway, but probably, as you said, 50% is industrial metal. So I might even tinker that. I think it's a 70% industrial metal. It's not precious anymore. So EV, I think automobile sector is much more, is going to drive this demand rather than photovoltaic demand. See, I think 23-24% is the total consumption of silver within the solar panels kind of thing. So, but automobile, especially the EV, is going to be a significant driver in the next 5-7 years.
Johnny, do you agree with them or do we have a different price view here too?
Well, as I mentioned earlier, I think silver in particular is very closely related with gold. It is often considered sort of gold's little sister. Given our price view for gold, we are actually looking for silver to trend lower as well. So we have a target of $25 by the end of this year and falling further to sort of an average of 24.5 over next year. And that probably puts us at around $22 by the end of 2022. I think the industrial side, I do agree that demand there is likely to continue growing. I think electric vehicles and the auto sector in general is a positive area for silver demand, not just because of the electrification part, but just as more electronics and navigation systems and all these things are embedded in vehicles. I think that supports silver demand over the long run. With regards to solar industry demand for silver, our base case there at the moment is that it will actually be pretty top-ish. Kind of plateauing at these quite higher levels, but we're not expecting very strong growth from that sector simply because we think there is still room for the thrifting in silver demand in photovoltaics to continue from here. I mean, there has already been a lot of thrifting that has happened over the last several years, but I think our view is that there is still room for that trend to continue further in the next few years.
Sure. I know we were supposed to take questions at the end of it, but since they're coming in right now, and since we are talking about metals, might as well take it right now. There is a question that has been put out which says that why is nickel not listed in India? I mean, there are nickel futures in India, but not so much in sense of nickel companies in India. Isn't that right, Kishore?
Yes, that's what I meant, actually. As far as stock market is concerned, we don't have any nickel companies in India.
So nickel is 100% imported into India. And while we do have a very buzzing nickel futures on the Indian exchanges here, and we do see price discovery as well. But as far as connecting it to the company in India, the listed companies, that isn't the case really. I want to talk about the crude oil prices now. And this clearly has been the last 1 year has been once in a lifetime experience for a lot of commodity watchers, economic watchers as well, because a negative $37 in sense of crude oil prices, and then 70 plus is where we're trading right now. You know, Kishore, when we talk about commodities, you and me, and we've been talking about this for the last couple of decades now, we've always gone and pitched saying that a commodity has an intrinsic value, commodity has a cost of production, commodity can never go to zero, but we've seen a negative this time around. So how do we read that? First of all, that, and then I will come to the question in the present.
Probably we are right. It will not go to zero. Maybe negative. So no complaints there. So it's a very as you said, it's a once in a lifetime. Maybe not even once in a lifetime. It's like once in many lifetimes actually. The kind of thing which we have witnessed, though a lot of people are still trying to understand. And so mind you, actually, it's a one particular. crude price at a particular geographic location. It's not the crude price didn't go into negative. It's for the particular variety of crude at a particular geographic location. It's been due to a technical issue, I don't mean the information technology kind of issue, like they don't have enough storage space to store that crude. So the storage cost became significantly higher than what the value of crude is, which tend to take it to the negative price. So that's the fundamental backdrop why crude went to negative. So other than that, in the same day, same settlement, probably the other Brent and other non-US crude still remained 36, 37, or even $40 plus. So that way, crude is something, it's extremely dynamic in nature. And as you said, we have witnessed from minus 37 to plus 70, 75, 78 kind of thing. But I think the OPEC plus has tasted blood now. That's something which I can put it in a way that OPEC has been doubting its ability to control crude prices for some time, for a while, especially if you go to last 3, 4, 5 years. Though OPEC was trying everything, but it was actually the price was determined by the shale oil producers from US. So US became the pricing point for crude rather than the Middle East. So after the pandemic, as the global economy recovers with the kind of production cuts they did, and before they actually thought of actually increasing the output, they saw the demand recovery, and suddenly they saw that, okay, we have the pricing power now, right? And the OPEC plus, including Russia, they were able to understand that dynamic has changed, and they're trying to squeeze in as much as possible and try to consolidate that power without giving enough leverage for the shale producers in US to take it away, right? I think they will be extremely mindful of that fact. Because the moment if they take it to 90, 100 on odd levels, of course, again, the pricing control will shift to shale again. So I think they have to maintain this balance. And today I can say that it's not fundamentally demand and supply, because demand is something which is no one controlling. It's natural, it's organic and all. But supply in crude is always controlled and determined by few people. So I think the players have, the cartel has actually consolidated its power. So they will keep it at these levels. Do you say that, are we into that $90-$100 territory? May not be. So I think 75 to 85 is something which I'm looking at. Probably they will push that envelope towards 85 and see and test the market whether it will be able to sustain or not. I think that's where it's going to be there. Maybe we will not go back to 65 kind of levels. So that's the kind of range which I'm looking at.
You know, Kishore, I've stopped smiling on TV when I report on crude oil prices that they are another 3% on the higher side, because I'm really hated for that. Because in the Indian markets, we have seen the petrol and diesel prices at an all-time highs. So when you say it's going to $85 per barrel, that means further hike in petrol and diesel prices in the Indian markets. What is your sense on the inflation part of that? I'm going to come to that, because when you look at a portfolio diversification, and the reason that we're talking commodities now on whether or not you should be holding it and where are we headed, where is the inflation going, that basically arises out of crude oil prices in a very big way. So how do you look at including perhaps crude as a part of portfolio going forward?
Yeah, crude, theoretically, crude is extremely important, or you can actually, it's even a better way of beating inflation than gold, let's say. Let's put it that way, theoretically. But practically, because these are derivatives, whenever you're into that kind of a bullish territory, the carry cost of the derivatives, that's the rollover cost, he actually considerably eats away your profits. And it becomes a significant burden for carrying that long positions. So I see crude exposure towards crude for investors is not extremely good, because we keep getting these inquiries when let's say at $30, $20, $12 or $15, we used to get a lot of calls that, "Key, I want to just buy crude and keep it for 5 years. I'm sure that will go to $50. Right, but there's no way you can do that, actually. You have to have, if you go into physical crude, because it has to have a specific way to store. You need to have a tankers, and you need to have either vessel or something like that. It's extremely difficult. Those people will squeeze the markets. So the players cannot make money. Looking at a long-term perspective, you can have a tactical investment, maybe for 15 day, a month, a couple of months, and come out of it easily. But longer term, it doesn't work, number one. Number two, as far as perspective is concerned, yes, it will have a significant impact in inflation. And in India also, I think the government has sensed it, ki I can actually push this envelopes further and further despite having any effect, negative effects on the inflation or growth, because right now government is not worried about the growth. They are worried about the fiscal deficit and how they can push the growth into the economy. So I think they will be pushing. Maybe they will be comfortable at 110, 120 rupees per liter of petrol also. But I don't think they will not budge at this point of time, because government is anyway in need of funds.
Okay, I missed that. Did you mention or did you predict the future petrol and diesel prices in India?
I can't help it. Probably you when you're saying 85, you multiply with dollar, I think you'll get it. I think 120, 124 is something which we can look at.
You're going to be.
I don't think we'll have any demand blip also there.
Oh, yeah, we haven't seen that happen right now. People actually are buying more cars. They are traveling in their private cars because of the COVID concerns. So yes, the cars will continue to be will be bought, and you will see people traveling in their cars. So yes, that demand is not going anywhere. And the government clearly making good use of that. You know, there was a question as well, and I'm going to try and look at this one. This one was on crude, which says, how do you see crude as a commodity? What are the prices that we are expecting as it directly correlates with inflation? So you've said $85 by the end of this year, Kishore. And what is your expectation for the next year?
I think, see, predicting crude for multi-years is just like putting your neck out and saying that, it's a roulette. So I don't see, because the fundamentals here change almost on a daily basis, right? And some Saudi royal family gives you some statement, or president of US comes up and says something. So it's a significant. So demand supply situation, we will be continue to be in a tighter space. So there will be always fundamentals supporting a slightly higher and tighter price, because that is going to be the responsibility of OPEC plus. They will continue to be, they are comfortable at the current supply situation. Yes, we have started seeing some cracks there where Dubai UAE started pushing that they wanted a slightly bit, because that's what happens. The moment you push it to 85, 90, then the market share starts to actually impact the cartel's unity. Then who wants to sell more out of that? Because everyone knows that's what maximum they can do. And beyond that, then they want to push the volumes. So which is the tactical way of pushing it. So I don't think the OPEC will take it, because now they have tested that. Okay, now they started getting that inputs. Okay, I need a slightly more market share. They don't want that to happen again and again. They will come to a conclusion here. But I think next year also, we might be actually coming down rather than going up. So I am seeing that next year probably will be back into that 60s kind of range rather than in the 70s range. So I'm actually slightly bearish if you're looking at more than 18 months perspective, but less than 18 months perspective, we should be bullish on the crude prices.
Okay. So this whole conversation about commodities being in a super cycle is something that we are done with, because that really hasn't been the case. Because in a super cycle, commodities get bought at every level. Even if the prices are going, there is demand at every level, which we haven't seen across commodities. And as you guys have mentioned, we are looking at commodity prices right now on the higher side. But next year, Joni especially doesn't expect precious metal prices to gain up. Kishore has said that not all metal prices will be stronger, even is the case with crude oil prices. So starting with you, Chirag, are you buying, did you at all buy into this whole super cycle story in case of commodities, and even a bull run for that matter? And would you say that there perhaps has been a limited bull run in some commodities?
I think, Manisha, it's important to understand what is the characteristics of a super cycle, or how does a commodity super cycle actually look, you know? Mm-hmm. And I think if I take back, to the time when I started my career way back in 2004, some of the, you know, that was actually what you could have called a super cycle, you know, when there was a structural change in many commodities, you know, demand was picking up, supply was becoming constrained. Are we probably in that kind of scenario? I don't think so. Yes, we've seen higher prices because of liquidity. We've seen higher prices because of loose monetary policy. Whether this can continue, I don't think so. According to me, this is not a commodity super cycle. This is a liquidity-driven rally, you know. And this is a liquidity-driven rally across asset classes, be it equities. You know, a lot of people ask us that whether we are in Indian equity bull run. We are actually in a global equity bull run where Indian equities are also participating sort of thing. So this according to me, is a liquidity-driven rally. It is not a commodity super cycle because we are not seeing a significant outstrip of demand versus supply. Or if I can use some fancy words, we are not seeing a demand-supply conundrum sort of thing, you know. That is something which is not happening. You know, demand will again come down once, you know, the liquidity eases. So to me, this is not a commodity super cycle, especially not what I've learned. You know, this is not what the commodity super cycle actually looks like.
All right. I mean, okay. Johnny, what is your sense? How would you term this recent run that we've seen in various commodities?
So our house view has always been, we haven't really been convinced that this commodity super cycle story. And I think I agree with some of Chirag's comments that, you know, the high prices that we've seen has been very much liquidity driven. And I think what has supported the previous commodity super cycle in the 2000s was that there was a persistent liquidity infusion. Monetary policy was in a commodative phase. But in this case, it's quite different. We've seen a very strong infusion of liquidity as a response to the pandemic. However, very quickly we are seeing sort of normalization is in the horizon. So, and from that perspective, the kinds of price moves that we've seen over the past year or so, you know, are unlikely to continue in that environment.
I'm sorry. Since we are all talking about correction, and we have seen many of the commodities come off their highs already, and the equity markets are still raging on the higher side, are there signs here that there is correction perhaps coming in that asset class also, Kishore?
Sorry, are you talking about equity correction?
Yes, I'm talking about asset class to asset class. If we've seen that happen in commodities, and if we don't believe that the commodity prices will continue to run the way they are we looking at profit taking, some correction in other asset classes?
Yes, I think every asset class is bound to be in that. So, but there are two, three things. One is, first, as we started this discussion there with saying that I don't acknowledge the commodities as an asset class itself, as a consolidated, as a single asset class. Maybe each commodity will be different. So a commodity super cycle, as you say, it never happens that all the commodities rally. So as Chirag said, probably a liquidity driven rally. Yes, it could happen. But if you see, current liquidity is multiple times of what we had post Lehman crisis liquidity, which Chirag was mentioning. So I think, so liquidity is even today. And what do you mean by super cycle? Probably copper prices have doubled almost. Crude, as you said, from minus 37 to plus 78. So is it not a super cycle? I don't know. So we might be in one. It's hard to recognize that. And it's hard to define what is a commodity super cycle. So probably we don't know. But as far as correction is concerned, yes. But I don't think the liquidity is not. I don't think the liquidity is going to dry up anytime soon. First thing is, I think there's no one on the panel which will believe that suddenly tomorrow the tapering will start and then liquidity will be sucked out. So maybe the additional liquidity. So the first is the Fed has to stop giving that additional liquidity. That's the bond purchase program has to be trimmed down. Similarly for ECB. And some of the countries like India, who have actually not infused too much liquidity, the central banks have been extremely careful to suck out whatever the additional liquidity came in, to not keep too much of money supply into the market. So we have been very cautious. So as we come out of this pandemic, hopefully in the next 6 months, 8 months, maybe 12 months, as the larger amount of population gets vaccinated, till that time, the liquidity will remain high. supply side constraints will remain as most of the workers come back. So today, when you see US labor markets itself, there is a huge significant amount of vacancies and unfilled vacancies. There's a shortage of labor. It doesn't mean that people are not there. Actually, people are not fully employed. But when you look at labor market itself, the availability of labor is not there today at this point of time. But at some point of time, as the economy recovers, the labor will come back and look for jobs. Then you'll see actual what is the joblessness. Today, your joblessness is much lower. So I don't see a correction immediately in the next 12 months or so. Maybe we can have that bull market corrections, maybe dips kind of things. But I don't see a turnaround or end of the story anytime soon, maybe at least a year from now.
Just a follow-up on that, and this is an interesting question from the audience that's come in for Joni. And since it's a follow-up of what Kishore just said, Joni, what is your sense? Because you expect the gold prices at $1,700, silver at around $25 by the end of this year. Because that you're expecting higher real yields due to inflationary pressure. Are you also expecting, when do you expect a 25 basis hike? I mean, do you expect it as early as this year or next year? What is the sense that you're making of the current market?
So our house view is in terms of Fed tapering, I think earlier than most are expecting. So we do expect an announcement sometime towards the end of this year. But in terms of the Fed hike, we think we're actually we expect it to be later than the market expects, especially after the market expectations have been brought forward following the June FOMC meeting. But we are still expecting that rate hikes is further away.
Sure. Okay. I want to actually take another question, and this is a very, very relevant one. And this one is to you, Chirag, and I would want Joni to answer this as well. When we talk about precious metals, we don't normally talk about the supply situation of precious metals. I mean, that is something that doesn't even get carried into the prices. Yes, in case of silver, because we've seen a few years of silver deficit, which is not the case this year, is yet another reason that silver prices have seen some pressure come in. But Chirag, when we look at demand, yes, supply, not so much.
Yeah, absolutely. I think one of the fact remains with regards to a lot of commodities like gold, silver, is there is also a certain amount of above ground supply, which is always there in the market. So, and we've always little seen supply disruptions over the years, you know, as such. I think what really drives platinum prices, what really drives some of the precious metal prices is probably the demand side and especially the investment demand. And that is why, you know, we often really talked about how the investment demand, especially the ETFs or the managed money positions or how the funds are, you know, placing them towards the precious metals. And we very little talk about probably supply side. So I agree with you. It's more to do with what drives the prices rather than what is driving the demand and supply as such.
On my part, I think to add to what Chirag has said is, and particularly this is particularly important for gold. Even though gold is a commodity, it really trades more like a macro asset, more like a currency, which is why when we think about gold price, gold price forecast, and where the market is likely going to go, think back to what our macro outlook is, what our expectations and rates are, what our expectations on the dollar. And at the end of the day, you could almost think about the gold market as two separate markets. One, there's the physical market where you actually have physical supply and demand. And then you also have the sort of financial market where, you know, it includes physical gold, metal accounts that are held in vaults in London, ETFs that are backed by physical gold. But then this also includes gold futures. And if you take the volumes that are traded in this part of the market, they far exceed the annual physical flow of supply and demand every year. And I think that's why, this part of the market and things like real rates and monetary policy are much stronger drivers for gold price than things like supply.
There's a very interesting question, and I want to take this one. It says, why India doesn't have commodity indexes on same lines of S&P, GSCI, UBS, etc.? So while, of course, India has a commodity indices and they have been introduced in last 1 hour, the liquidity is still building up onto this one. So we have a bullion index, we have a metal index, and there also is an agri index here. Kishore, why don't you take up all of these indexes? And for gold index, then I'll go to Chirag here.
Yeah, see, indices brings you an opportunity to invest in a basket of commodities. So basically, that's the idea. And also, when you are like when you have this conundrum of that in non-ferrous metals, should I be picking up nickel or should I be picking up copper or something? Probably, if you are bullish on the economy, industrial production, etc., probably you have to pick up the entire basket of industrial metals. So that's where the metal index comes into play. And within gold and silver, again, so whether rather than you need to choose between these two commodities and what ratio need to be there, probably you can do. And also, secondly, the indices actually gives us an opportunity to in future fund managers, because as the PMSs and mutual funds are allowed in India, so probably the fund managers should be able to benchmark their respective portfolio performance versus against an index. So that gives them as a basis for performing in the asset class, probably. So I think these are the three typical uses of index. So we are right now bullish on metal index, but not really bullish on precious metals index. That's a bull index. Again, looking at the volatility of silver. So basically, if you want to buy gold as an investment in derivatives, as a retail investor or a smaller investor who doesn't want to take delivery or has nothing to do with that as an asset class, probably you should be picking up bull index, because that will give you a smaller component of silver, which is like 30% or 30% odd levels, and which gives you that enough beta to beat gold's volatility and give you slightly higher returns or slightly higher volatility, where you, when you do it, is these kind of tactical investments like 15 days, 20 days, 30 days kind of a view, it gives you enough volatility to come out of your trade at a right time, and gives you that because the people we are assuming that the people who come to commodity markets likes volatility, and that gives you that additional volatility.
Yeah. Chirag, you want to go on the bulldex part of it?
No, I think, look, you know, our market is still developing. There are still a lot of regulatory changes which is coming in. I think this bulldex, you know, the precious metals index, tradable index, which was introduced, options which were introduced, will obviously have a broader participation for a lot of people. And I think Kishore hit the nail on the head. You know, you want to have an additional beta, you go in for the index because it allows you to have a play on both gold as well as silver. So I would say these are very good additions, but a lot of changes are happening in the market, and eventually hoping that, you know, truly the Indian commodity market comes into its own in next, you know, maybe 5 or 6 years, a lot of other additions which are likely to happen.
Jodi, I want to ask you this. You know, when in Indian markets, it's only very few sophisticated investors who would buy or trade in equities and then in some indices and then, hedge that exposure by buying into or selling into underlying commodities as well. What is your sense on what kind of a correlation do you have you been able to make within various commodities, precious metals to begin with?
So I guess within precious metals, what typically investors tend to look at would be the gold-silver ratio, or perhaps the platinum-palladium ratio. Look at the gold-platinum spread as well, things like that. And I think at the end of the day, I don't think there should be sort of a specific level that fundamentally, you know, these ratios need to be at. But I think it is useful for investors in trying to understand whether one commodity or one precious metal is overvalued or cheap relative to the other. I think for silver, that's typically the case. You know, given the very strong correlation between gold and silver, typically when there is a big move in the ratio and either the direction, and then the typical assumption after that would be that you'll see sort of a reversion. maybe because silver looks too cheap relative to gold or vice versa. And for platinum and palladium as well, I think that is typically closely watched as well by investors. But I would say for platinum and palladium, there's probably more of a fundamental reason as well, because given that these metals are being used in the auto sector and to an extent, it can substitute for the other. So the actual price difference between the two metals could actually have implications on technologies as well and how they are used.
Fair point. Kishore, when people look at Titan, they look at gold. When they look at Hindustan Zinc, they look at zinc. For gold, they also look at Muthoot and Manappuram kind of companies. Have you guys, as a brokerage, been able to make those linkages here to your investors?
So just a disclaimer, Manisha, though I'm not an equity analyst for that matter. Yes, see, these are very different models. So probably if you look at companies like Hindalco or any of these non-ferrous metal producers, they also have gold and silver as their portfolios because gold and silver is part of their refining of all the other metals. So to some extent, that's built into their profits as well. But as far as Muthoot and Manappuram kind of say, these are the gold lenders. So there are many other factors other than gold which influences them, their cost of funding, their kind of NPA ratios. It adds a lot more complexity for an investment into a company which is lending against gold. So if you are bullish on gold, just go plain buy gold. Gold has many other instruments, like not only derivatives, probably you can have ETFs, probably you have sovereign gold, you have products like Me Gold, which is digital gold. So there are various ways of doing it. So rather than, I would like to uncomplicate it rather than going to a complicated way of doing it.
All right, point taken. And this is a question that I really love. This is about what is your view on cryptos and are they related to gold or is crypto a competition to gold? Chirag, you want to take it up?
I don't look at it as a competition to gold, to be very honest. Gold has its own fundamentals. Also, you just look at the size of the market, you know, gold market, and I don't have the exact figure. Gold market is multiple times, you know, bigger than the crypto market. Yes, you know, you will have a certain amount of excitement of investing in crypto. You've got likes of Dogecoin, which goes up by 40-50% in a day. So yes, you know, it has got that unique value. And that's why people will always talk about. But I would look at it from a fundamental point of view. I don't see a competition as in, you know, gold versus crypto. I would say, you know, if you want to have a certain amount of excitement, go ahead and, you know, buy cryptos. You know, each one has their own fundamentals in that sense.
Okay. Kishore, when we look at EV, and that clearly has been the whole conversation, and this is an interesting question, which commodities will see a bull run when EVs become a norm? I mean, there is a lot of, you know, target years and forecasts that we've been reading for last many years now. The numbers are definitely looking better, but silver, nickel, copper, we already spoke about on how they are a part of EV as we go ahead. What other metals do you think would be part of this?
If you start looking at EV story, nickel and copper is the primary foremost metals, which will go into that, number one. See, number one is the component of electrical wiring is copper, and the battery technology is nickel is going to be dominating the battery technology, these two. And the third is that you need to have lower weight of vehicles. So probably they will actually trim off a lot of metal parts. Anyway, the engine is gone, so the combustion engine is gone, so that saves a lot of space as well as weight reduction. They might be using more and more plastics and fiber kind of things. So I think it's going to be purely these metals. Plus, over and above that, how the distribution of electricity as far as... So one is looking at the manufacturing of car itself. The second is the charging stations. So you need to have enormous amount of infrastructure to be built in. So it's like building the entire infrastructure of petrol pumps. So now you need to have charging stations there in parking lots, in malls, in homes, in home building parkings, wherever it requires a lot of copper as a wiring, as well as the charging units are concerned. So nickel and copper are the best bets as far as EV story goes.
And Kishore, what's your sense on steel and iron ore? Of course, we spoke about that. But in the whole EV story, clearly, these are a couple of metals which do not stand a chance. And as markets have been telling us, that there is not another industrial revolution coming in. There's an infrastructure right. happening, but that's about it. And you know, this whole conversation about that next 10 years, it is going to belong to metals. Are you buying into that story?
See, I think China has built its infrastructure now. Whatever the additional they are building is just to keep the economy running now, right? So, but I think US is going to rebuild its entire infrastructure. I think that's become legacy. It's become old, so they have to break down a lot of things and rebuild them. Maybe they have to expand a lot of things. So there's a significant push coming from US as an infrastructure push. And second is South America is again it's building a lot of infrastructure. Southeast Asia, including India, again, we are in the middle of entire infra boom, which started maybe 10, 12 years back. It's still at the right speed. Either it's building of highways or building of metros across. So that's going to be there. So will this entire boom will be replacing China, which has actually given that boom from 2004-05 to 2012, kind of that scenario? I'm not sure on that. So on the ferrous side, strategically for the next 12 to 18 months, they might be looking good. But beyond that, I'm not a big fan of ferrous metals.
All right. So as we are approaching our time on this panel, there's one question that I want to ask each one of you, and that is on how would you look at a portfolio from here on for a short-term investor, for a long-term investor as well? Kishore, why don't you go first?
Sorry, can I get the question back?
For a portfolio diversification, for a portfolio to be made for a short-term and a longer-term scenario, how should it really look when you look at equities, bonds, commodities, currencies? What do you think it should have a mix of?
I think short term, when you're looking at short term mix, probably a 30% weight to commodities at this point of time, because especially being an industrial metal rally is continuing, and you can have a little bit of gold and maybe a little bit of energy, maybe it could be even natural gas have seen a significant rally. So we could have that kind of portfolio. But if you're looking at a medium to longer term, probably again, the portfolio ratio depends upon your end goal. Your financial planning, your age, your risk-taking capability and your expectations of returns also. But if you go by book, probably if you're in the middle age and go by book, probably 15 to 18%, 20% is a decent portfolio allocation. Again, that doesn't mean that you are going to trade in derivatives and commodities and all those things. Probably you can have your jewelry as part of component. Companies which actually have this exposure to commodities also part of your commodities exposure. So you have to look at portfolio diversification as consolidated. That doesn't mean that you have to buy 30% of your portfolio into gold. So I think people just get confused and have this. So 20% of your portfolio weightage into commodities or commodity related stocks which can give you that benefit of commodities should be an ideal portfolio.
Okay. I have a few questions that we can take right now. One is, most of the commodities listed in India show inefficiency or weak efficiency at its best. Do you also subscribe to this view, especially in futures market? Well, when it comes to the Indian futures market, Kishore, for the longest time, we've been looking for more participation. It's only after SEBI became a regulator here, we've seen more instruments, we've seen more opening up of the market, we've seen better regulations, etc., and surveillance for that matter. How would you look at the Indian futures market right now?
I didn't get what the efficiency means in what kind of efficiency. Maybe it could be liquidity. Maybe it could
participation
be
participation and liquidity is what I'll go with.
Right. So I think as far as the top 10 commodities are concerned, especially the metals or metals portfolio, the efficiency to trade, that means the spreads between bid and ask are very competitive, very much in line with what the global markets are. They're liquid enough and all. But the only thing is the composition of participants is not in line with the global market. So it's purely dominated by algos and retail investors. The corporate side or the commercial side, which we can say, is very small. Even in the in the much more developed market like gold. The corporate participation is very insignificant as far as volumes are concerned. Maybe in the open interest, there is a large corporate participation. The open interest will be there. But as far as daily volume is concerned, the commercial side is not there.
Johnny, this one is to you. At UBS, when you are following a lot of market geographically, which markets do you see best performing? I mean, we do understand it's majorly about US and the exchange in China. Are the other markets as efficient?
So as far as gold is concerned, in terms of what we track quite closely, it's really China and India from a physical standpoint. So I think those are very important markets to keep track of. I guess from a kind of financial participation in the gold market, the US and the local London trading of gold are probably the key ones. In terms of physical, I think the other ones after China and India, probably Europe also tends to have a pretty strong sort of physical demand for gold. So I would say these would probably be the key areas that we look at.
There also is a question, Kishore, on the expected price views going forward when it comes to commodities or metals like lead, etc.
I see lead and zinc, both the minor metals, have a little bit of steam left in probably, but another 15% or so. But they're going to be volatile. They're nearing their tops. So it needs to be extremely traded with caution. So I can say that.
Okay. Chirag, let me come to you. I mean, we'll keep taking the questions in middle, but what is your sense also on how should a portfolio look for a short term and a longer term, in sense of a longer term strategy here?
So I think, you know, as I said earlier, I think 5% probably exposure is something that should be their minimum. And then you could keep on changing your exposure as per time. But I think from an Indian perspective, a lot of us have jewelry and we term that as our exposure to gold. Actually, that is not how it should be. You know, our exposure to gold should be in form of either, you know, bars, coins or ETFs or even sovereign gold bond, which is a fantastic way to get exposure towards gold because you get both the benefit of the price as well as the interest rate. So, you know, I would look at gold purely from that point of view rather than adding jewelry as part of your portfolio. That is not the case. Always, you know, it's important to have an investment product of gold in your portfolio. So I would say at this moment, still continue to have maybe higher than 5%, maybe 10% exposure to gold. But then over the next, you know, couple of years time, it would be prudent to trim that given that we don't have a fairly constructive view on gold.
Okay. And Johnny, what is your sense? As we've already spoken, that given the kind of age, risk-taking ability that you have and what products are available is what should really be in a part of your portfolio. What is your sense when you look at a shorter-term portfolio or a longer-term portfolio? How would you want to imbibe precious metals into this?
So if we're talking about short term, I think for gold, let's say for this quarter, we are expecting that prices will consolidate at this point. So probably not a very interesting, like, just from a short term standpoint, not a very interesting asset class to be actually participating actively unless you wanted to trade that range. Over a long term perspective, as I mentioned, I think gold continues to be a relevant portfolio diversifier, and so strategic interest is likely to be quite resilient. We did some studies on portfolio optimization, basically looking at a simple stock bond portfolio and seeing, you know, what is the optimal amount of gold to hold. And over a 30-year horizon, about 5% seemed to be a good portion of gold to hold. But it really depends when you break it down to periods of recession or expansion or some sort of consolidation in growth, then the amount of gold that is optimal tends to change. So for instance, during periods of a recession, holding more gold is ideal, but in periods when global growth is very, very strong, then very limited amounts of gold it would be optimal for that type of portfolio.
Point taken. There also is one more interesting question that I can see, which says that would the EV transition boost ferrous metals purely based on the volumes of units and related infrastructures? I'm assuming, yes, that is really the case, because that would tell you on how much demand that we're looking at. And of course, there is supply side to it. But Kishore, what's your sense?
No, I think it's a pure demand side equation, because supply side is not something which you can suddenly ramp it up. Nickel is something that, yes, Philippines can ramp up a little bit of production, because they have shut down some of the production, which can come back with the improved pollution norms and etc., which was the reason for that. But I think there are some metals like rare earths, where typically are going to be a critical play in this entire EV boom. These are finer points, but I think the volume of metal which is getting consumed in this industry, again, I'm saying not only in the manufacturing of cars, but it's also the other ancillary infrastructure which is going to be supporting this entire boom is going to be humongous for these two metals.
Correctly. So, you know, when we go ahead, when we talk about commodities, and Chirag, I can start this one with you. What is your sense on how would you rate commodities, let's say, 3 years from now, 5 years from now? What is your sense on where the commodities will stand tall as? And I'm talking about the whole gamut here itself, because we've spoken about individual commodities. We've spoken about where the demand will come from, the supply concerns, China and other countries as well. But when you look at overall commodities in your portfolio, what is your sense on where are we headed?
I think, look, you know, probably if we were to look at commodities and you would divide them into safe haven, commodities and maybe industrial commodities, you know, probably the industrial commodities would do well, because, you know, the textbook tells you that once the economy starts recovering, you will have higher demand, and that would obviously help the prices. And, you know, probably as the economy starts improving, your interest rate starts going up, your safe havens would not do well. So I would stick to, you know, that kind of, you know, basic understanding that the safe haven assets may not do that great, whereas, you know, obviously your industrial assets and the commodities, which are largely very much sensitive to the economic growth, would obviously continue to do well. Now, obviously, you will have different cycles in that. So, you know, it's very difficult to comment, as such where it would be. But if the larger economies, especially the ones like US, China, and Europe continues to do well, we'll have a much higher, industrial commodity prices in that.
Well, you can't have commodity prices too high. That is something that we've already seen, because that can also threaten derailing of the economic recovery that we are seeing. We've already spoken about the OPEC trying to do that. China, in some senses, also have been doing that, because that had started to kill the margin of the manufacturers there. So, Kishore, how would you look at commodities as overall? Because there has to be a fair price. There has to be the right price going forward. Where do you see that being discovered in the next 3 to 5 years?
Manisha, I think I think economically it's wrong principle to say that the higher commodity prices deter the economy. Maybe, at the same time, if you see the earnings of people improved on that basis, right, the wage growth happens. So typically, whether the wage growth causes the higher demand, or whether the higher demand causes the wage growth, it's not. I think it's the other way. Today, as we see, hourly earnings started to improve. So as people have a more disposable incomes, whether it is relatively in real money terms, it might not be, but in a fiat currency terms, it might be higher as the dollar depreciates or rupee depreciates, your income goes up and you tend to demand more commodities, or more, you tend to consume more commodities. Eventually it will rise. So I am able to afford that prices because my wages have already grown to that extent, right? Otherwise, commodity prices would never grow without that demand. So where the demand means that people are able to afford it. Otherwise, there's no demand, right? So I think it's a kind of a chicken and egg story. I think both will rise. The wages will rise and the commodity prices will rise, which is nothing but inflation. It is inflation. That is what is going to happen. So what my theory is that the rate hikes will be much slower than what the inflation can rise to, and the real returns will actually keep falling as the inflation goes higher and higher, and the rate hikes will be slower. I'm not saying that the rate hikes will not happen, but they will not happen as faster as the inflation could spike. So that will actually cause the real rates to fall and still continue to be a positive for the safe havens.
Point, Joni, when you follow something as precious as gold, you end up following inflation and currencies and the global markets and the central banks and everything around that. How would you look at these markets? I mean, you are slightly bearish when it comes to gold and silver this year and the next as well. But for a larger view, I mean, as Kishore also pointing out, how are you looking at the next 3 to 5 years within the space?
So I think for white metals, so silver and PGMs, over that sort of time frame, I think the fundamentals will start to kick in and then become a key driver, and particularly for platinum and palladium. For gold, I think what will really determine it is sort of the macro backdrop. So is this recovery, how long is this recovery going to continue? When will be that point that the global growth becomes sort of start to slow down and sort of consolidate, and you know what the Fed will actually do at this point. You know, we have a lot of expectations, we have our base case, but does it actually play out? Do we have a is there going to be another external shock over that time frame, and even in a shorter time frame, you know, are our expectations on how the pandemic is going to play out and when we're going to get out of this, will it actually happen the way we expect? And I think that will have implications all over a 3 to 5 year horizon as well, on the macro on the macro backdrop, and therefore will determine how gold will trend during that time as well.
Okay, I have a minute left, but there's a very interesting question, this one. Kishore, why don't you take it? It says, are the commodity prices a leading indicator for economic growth or recession? Yes, they are. I mean, we call copper Dr. Copper for a reason, but would you put that for across commodities?
Yeah, any asset price is an indication of the health of the economy, right? The asset prices, whether it is real estate, whether it is commodities, any hard assets will start to raise as there is more surplus or disposable incomes available to gather, because these are finite amount of assets which are available, whether it is real estate or whether it is commodities, and there is a finite amount of things which you produce, and the currency is something which is infinite. You can just keep printing as much money as possible, and as the economies try to recover through printing, then people tend to demand more commodities or more assets, anything. So in that kind of, and where the money doesn't have any cost, today the interest rates are so low that it's the negligible. So you can buy any asset and sit on that, and even returns of 10% looks amazing for that. So people tend to buy these things. People are liquidating fixed deposits to buy stocks. That happens. If today our fixed deposit returns were like 8.5%, 9% interest, probably no one will put money in stocks. So similarly, at 3.5%, 4% FD rates, of course, people will look for alternate opportunities. So it's all a game of how you dispose of that additional capital which you have in your hand, and try to buy these assets, which create the asset prices.
All right. So inflation is a thing that will continue, and we have a divided house when, as far as the precious metal price view is concerned, but not exactly divided. It's 2:1. But Joni, it wants to stand tall on there. Crude oil prices, yes, further gains can be expected. And when it comes to the metals or the industrial commodities, well, EV, green metals, infrastructure demand, all of that will continue to push that ahead as well. So super cycle, maybe not, but strong commodity prices going forward, definitely, yes. With that, it's back to you.
Thank you so much, Manisha, Chirag, Kishore, and Joni, for such an insightful session. I have my own learning takeaways. on looking at commodities at macro levels to pricing trends, factors affecting the same, so to allocation to one's portfolio. I feel all the participants have their own takeaways from the session. Thanks again for such an insightful session.